Then we have to improve energy delivery mechanisms. And the analogy which I like to use is the car analogy. And for your car to go, you've got to have the right fuel in the tank, and that's all about ketones. Then we need some oxygen, and we'll talk about the nitty-gritty of that. And then, of course, the mitochondrial engine. And this conference, of course, it revolves around mitochondria. Mitochondria are so important. And I believe that mitochondrial lesions are the central problem that we see in people with the clinical picture of chronic fatigue syndrome. Then we have to look at, as I call it, the thyroid accelerator pedal and the adrenal gearbox. And we have to do these things in the right order, because thyroid hormones and adrenal hormones, they manifest through their action on mitochondria. So to put all this stuff in place, we have to do it in the right order. Now, we can do this very quickly over a few days and a few weeks at maximum. But what I'm trying to say is there's no point just trying to fix the thyroid gland if you haven't sorted out the mitochondrial engine. And to fix the mitochondrial engine, you need the right fuel in the tank. You need the ketogenic diet. So that's, I say, the analogy that I like to use, that I get it. And guess what? Most of my patients get it too. Now, so how do we know that mitochondria are the central lesion in people who have fatigue syndromes? And this is the resume of a paper that John McLaren Howard, Professor Norman Booth, and myself published in 2009. That's the abstract. But the most important, this is the most important graph to come out of that study. And essentially, I took patients with whom I was still struggling, who had chronic fatigue syndrome, and we agreed an energy score. And on this graph, you can see the energy score, CFS ability, along the bottom of the graph. We then did the blood test, look at mitochondrial function, which were done by John McLaren Howard at Acumen Laboratory. Again, he didn't know how disabled the patients were. He just did the tests. And then all the data was sent to Professor Norman Booth up at Mansfield College, Oxford, and he wrote up the paper. And this was the most important graph to come from that study. And here you can see that those people who had the worst level of fatigue with very poor CFS ability scores had the worst level of mitochondrial function and vice versa. And compared with a group of 51 controls, you can see this was a very significant result. Again, what's interesting here is age didn't impact on mitochondrial function at all. So when we did a graph of age against mitochondrial function, it was a scatter graph. So what this means is our mitochondria can work perfectly well for us throughout life. And mitochondria also determine the aging process. And if we look after our mitochondria well, then we can retain youthful energy levels. And that's really important, because I want to live my life to its full potential in terms of quality of life and quantity of life. So we then asked the question, are these interventions effective? And this was from our third paper, where we did a follow-up looking at patients who'd done the regimes compared with some who'd not done the regimes. And again, this was the graph that came out of this. So these codes along the bottom are code names for the patients. This is the mitochondrial energy score on the y-axis here. And in purple, this is their mitochondrial function before. And in a sort of orangey color, this is the mitochondrial function after the package of supplements, the regimes, which we'll talk about in a second, that we know that we were using to treat the mitochondrial dysfunction. And as you can see, in this first 30-odd patients, the mitochondrial function improved in every single patient without fail. And then I had four patients who, for reasons best known to themselves, didn't do the interventions. They couldn't manage the diet, they didn't take the supplements, they didn't do the detox regimes. I'm not quite sure why they wanted to be retested, quite honestly, but there we go. And what you can see is that in all four cases, the mitochondrial function got worse. So although the numbers are rather small, they're all case studies, these are all real people, real patients, although the numbers are small, the statistics were very powerful. And what that tells me is that we don't have to do expensive mitochondrial function tests in all our patients to improve their mitochondrial function. We just put in place the regimes. So that's very nice to know, because so often patients I see, they can't work because they have a chronic fatigue syndrome, they don't have the energy to work, and therefore they don't have much money. So the regimes I'm asking these sufferers to do have to be doable, and they have to be affordable. And guess what? These all are.